Now I am. Great. Let's go.
Quick. Yeah. Cool. So do you want to start with
Hi, my name's Alan, Alan Herbert. I've lived in Riverside now for 37 years, just a couple of streets away from where we are now. I also work in the area in a community setting. Brought up in an environment of volunteering. My father was belonged to a thing, it's not so well known now, it's called the BAPS, which is like a sort of an organisation that helps people. Stands for the Royal Antediluvian Order of Buffalo, which is a kind of a strange name, but there's a lot of volunteering to help families. It's where I was born, Pontypridd, that worked so well off, and we did a lot of work around that. My mother was also a strong volunteer. She was a part of a choir that used to go and sing in hospitals, and then she worked for the Women's World Voluntary Service for many years again in hospitals. So I was surrounded by volunteering when I was growing up, so I didn't have to learn about volunteering. It was part of my life. I've done lots of smaller bits of volunteering. I'll talk specifically about probably the most major thing I've done, which is to do with a building which is I'm looking at right now in Riverside. It's called the Riverside Warehouse. And that was a building that was a warehouse. That's why it's called the Riverside Warehouse. And as part of the process of the area of Riverside going through some big regeneration of buildings, there was a little bit which is about community spaces. And there was a community consultation where there were different options. They were going to knock the building down because it was kind of falling down. But enough people came forward and said they'd like it kept for some sort of community use. By this point, the four children, and the two of them were sort of 6 and 7 years old, and I'd begun to realise that there wasn't anything for them in the area. So that was a driver for me to try and do something for my own children and for their friends. That was began with me. And I became part of an action group to save the warehouse. We managed to get, with the local authority and other government money to rebuild the building. And we formed into a group, we formed then into a charity. I was the chair of that charity for some 7 years. But the amount of volunteering that went in, I was a very active chair in that I was in the building a lot, volunteering day in, day out. I do a lot of fundraising, raise hundreds of thousands of pounds to keep the centre going. I learned how to run a charity. I learned how to run payrolls. That's how I used to do all of that. I was a caretaker. So I'd come out and open the building up all times of different times of the day and night. I was the main person for alarm call out, so often I'd come out and come out in the middle of the night because the alarm had gone off. And I did that for 7 years. I got a lot out of it. That type of volunteering, when you're providing a service for people, you get, it's like immediate gratification. And the gratification comes from just seeing hundreds of kids going in and out the building. I'm looking at it now as part of the festival today, and I know that building wouldn't be there if it hadn't been for the efforts of myself and a small group of volunteers. So that's gratification, you know. So a lot of it is about that, but I think most people that do genuinely volunteer are not boastful about it. They just get on and do it, and the gratification comes from seeing things better for other people. You know, you just get a nice warm glow, basically. And I continue to get that. You know. So that's the main thing for me. I've got a couple of instances I'll talk about, which is just kind of spontaneous things that kind of show you how the whole thing got accepted by local people, particularly young people. And young people do tend to get a lot of bad press, if you like, you know. People tend to go, oh, it's all the fault of the young people. Why are those young people around you? Why are they kicking balls against my wall? Why are they doing this? Why are they doing that? And at the bottom end of it is the fact that they're doing it because there's not enough positive things for them to get involved with. So they're just veering to things which often are not negative, but are perceived as negative. The charity we ran, we did kind of run out of steam after about 7 years. We ran it without any money from the local authority. We ran it just through fundraising and getting grants in. And it did wear us down in the end, I must admit, you know, because we were in the full-on youth service 5 days a week, employing people, managing a building, we were doing all of that. So it did, as a charity, we got to the point where we just couldn't do it anymore. And we passed it on to other organisations, the organisation I currently work for now has a lease on the building, and so the building's kept going. It's just a charity, we just got worn out with it. But there was a period two things happened in the midst of all of that. The building had to shut for about a 2-year period before other systems were in place to reopen it again. And there were two things that happened while the building was shut, which I think is a really good indication about the impact these things make. One was a tragic incident where a young girl, she was one of twins in the area, she was about 15, 16, and she was involved in a very, very sort of bizarre and tragic road accident. She got killed in a car crash on a motorway. And the young people in the area, without any prompting or anything, the building was shut, remember, by this time. It wasn't even open as a youth centre. They used the windows of the building as their memorial. They came along and they wrote their messages on the windows of the warehouse. They wrote in pens, they wrote in felt pens, all over the windows. It was the way that they marked the passing of this girl. And so their sense of ownership of the building was such that this is where they self-chose to make a memoriam to a girl that died. And there was maybe 100 or more messages written on the windows of a church building, all in memoriam, which I found massively touching. And the other one, which I'll mention, which I think is a really good example, is when the building was shut, there was a time when, even though it was shut for public use, we still had the keys, and we used to let people who were doing various projects store things there, because it was somewhere they could store things. And I was coming back, walking through the area one winter night, and it was about 9 o'clock at night, and it was dark, and I walked past, and I saw the way into the warehouse is through some shutter doors. I saw the shutter doors open, and there were two young guys standing in the doorway. I thought, oh, what's happened? You know, I couldn't figure out what happened, but, you know, because the shutters were open. All I could figure was maybe they got the lock of the shutters or something. So I walked over to speak to these two young guys, who were about 14, 15, and they said, oh, good, you've come. They were standing guard because they saw the shutter open. Somebody had forgotten the shutter. They saw it open, and they were just standing there to make sure nobody went in and caused any damage until somebody came along that could do something about it. So both those incidents to me are like really the clear indications of the impact that the volunteering has had, because it's created this massive sense of people feeling that they belong to something, but there's something there for them, and I find that so gratifying.